Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Relighting the Cauldron, Embracing Nature Spirituality in Our Modern World, by Reverend Wendy Van Allen, narrated by Carrie Coello. No tree, it is said, can grow to heaven unless its roots reach down to hell. Carl Jung. Prologue. In the beginning. In the beginning, long after the last of the great reptiles died off or shifted their shapes into birds, a hairy, bipedal creature began its ascent to the stars. This creature was a mammal, living as all other mammals do, in oneness with Mother Earth, in relationship with the other life forms, in fear of the great cats and hyenas that made it their prey, and in wonder at the forces of nature and the bowl of heaven that embraced it in a dark cocoon each night. This mammal came in both male and female forms, mating as the other animals did when it was time to mate. They lived together, probably nesting in trees and safe hidden places, on the great savanna of the continent of Africa. These beings lived by foraging food sources, such as fruits, nuts, tubers, and insects, and other small animals or animal carcasses they scavenged after the other predators had had their fill. They were communal creatures, with mothers and their young taking primacy, defended and fought over by the male members of the tribe. These family groups worked together to thrive, defend themselves, and reproduce. One group discovered if they cracked stones together skillfully, they could create tools to better process the bones of the animals they scavenged. This species reproduced and passed down their genes successfully, leaving their remains in the dust of the savanna, and later becoming known to us as Homo habilis, the first toolmakers, or handy men. Over many centuries, a great shape-shifting of these early people began. A taller, less hairy form developed. The tools they created from carefully selected stones now included a heavy hammerstone, an axe, and flint blades. They left their home among the large mammals and dreamscape of the high African savanna and began to range farther. They came to be known as Homo erectus because they stood completely erect. They discovered fire and processed their food. The scavenging and foraging developed now into a more sophisticated knowledge base of what to eat, what to hunt, what goes where, what will kill, and what will heal, and perhaps even what made visions that brought dreams, knowledge, and insight. Over time, these early people continued to shift their shapes, to develop their tools and defenses, and to explore. Some new forms emerged, and many ages ago, more than one form of these early hominids lived and ranged and competed for resources in the ancient world. They traveled as far away from Africa as the southern continent of Australia, the high steppes of Asia, and the frozen terrain of Europe. Eventually, only one type of human survived. What happens to the others remains a mystery, lost in the great span of time. These humans were skilled hunters of big game and advanced foragers of food and medicine. They lived a nomadic lifestyle, following the animals they relied on and seeing them as relatives who fed them and provided them with food, bones, and skins. Around the campfire, in caves, and in more sophisticated nomadic skin-covered homes, they developed culture, language, song, and spiritual beliefs. To them, all the other life forms, all the natural wonders that surrounded them, had spirit, as they did. To them, all animals and living things shared in an innate knowledge for how to live well on the earth. They shared in the original knowledge and interdependence with the Creator. Deep in the caves, they created masterpieces of art, paintings drawn in vision and trance by their holy people, honoring the sacred dance of the hunt and their relationship with the animals and other beings. They buried their dead in the earth, smearing their bones with red ochre, a reminder of the blood they too were born with, and returned the body to the Great Mother's womb for rebirth. Their lives were brief and difficult. Eons of time elapsed. The ages of the earth came and went. The ice receded, and with it, continents and mountains cleared and became habitable for people, while great mammals disappeared. The humans, too, evolved and changed. The wisest of them began to realize that seeds planted in the Earth Mother would create stable crops, and that some beasts could be tamed to live among them to raise for food and to help plant crops, a dramatic shift in life ways that no longer required people to follow the herds. Over time, and with a new understanding of the cycles of seasons, settlements appeared, and with them, people began to build in stone. Large, megalithic structures, circles to meet in, to study, worship, and connect with the heavens, were created. As were earthen barrows in high and remote places, created with many stones and covered in earth to serve as repositories for ancestors. These burial mounds and circles oriented toward the rising sun at certain times of its cycle, which suggested the people now had sophisticated knowledge of the heavens. They may have revered the sun as a sacred being, a deity perhaps, something to celebrate. The stone-building culture formed patterns over Mother Earth, possibly tracing currents of telluric energies, able to be recognized and utilized by a people who depended so closely on her for sustenance, a skill we, their descendants, have lost over time. Language, song, dance, custom, religion, art, astronomy, science, medicine, all of these became part of the cultural fabric of these still early people. The Sky Father emerged alongside the Great Mother, their divine child representing the eternal cycles of rebirth and fertility of the earth. Human lifespans extended. The role of elders began to emerge as important members of the tribes. They held the memory, knowledge, and wisdom of their ancestors. They were the keeper of the songs and were instrumental in raising and educating the young, as farming community life was still hard for the strong younger adults. From small communities rose larger settlements. From shared communal resources, certain humans, through competition and competency, began to raise themselves to be a new ruling class, a people who would later be seen as a divinely ordained aristocracy, kings, queens, lords, and ladies. The new class system also created a priestly caste. From humble beginnings of the early tribal leaders known to us today in anthropology as shamans, a new class of dedicated individuals would become the priestesses and priests of these early civilizations. Complex societies were born. Labor and resources now were divided between these classes, and the working peasants served them in exchange for protection from other competitive warring tribes. Spirituality transformed into religion. Humans invented writing and began to keep detailed records of resources, myths, legends, histories, beliefs, customs, laws, and property. Commerce, trade, and market economies were born. Others domesticated the horse, and entire clan groups rose to maximize the use of these animals, growing into warrior cultures, able to raid and plunder the settled communities with great speed and efficiency. Within their own cultures, their leaders were seen as heroes who were granted a divine right to rule. New gods appeared among these people, no longer only forces of nature, but deities representing psychological aspects of humanity. Gods of love, wisdom, crafts, and war were worshipped, placated, and revered. Humans themselves, those from the ruling class, demanded worship. As these transformations took place, As the societies shape-shifted into complexes of civilization, competition and conflict followed. Humans competed for resources, for mates, for wealth, for ownership of land, and for ownership of other humans. Through all this, the older ways that marked simpler agrarian and nomadic communities, those of commonly shared resources and power, were relegated to the status of outsiders, now considered a primitive and savage people. It was determined that these should be the slaves, serfs, and subjects of the ruling classes of civilization. Metals were discovered deep within the earth, and skilled craftspeople called smiths began to work these metals into weapons and precious jewelries for the gods, and as status symbols for people of wealth. The Stone Age gave way to the Neolithic, and then the Bronze Age, which developed into an Iron Age, where might made right. In many places, women lost their status as rulers, and their roles as priestesses and healers, and became the property of men. Most humans became servants and subjects of lords and kings. Some were reduced to slaves, but all became subservient to the rule of those who controlled the beliefs of the society, the priests. At this time, civilizations began to embrace the idea of one god alone to rule all others. Even where some old pantheons of gods remained, civilization furthered this hierarchical and increasingly patriarchal ordering of humanity. The paradigm of domination ascended and replicated itself across the earth. In most large civilizations, people embraced this as God's way, relegating the older ways to the hidden peoples of the jungle, countryside, and remote mountain plains. Civilization marched on, and now the descendants of the early humans resided in urban areas, populations of skilled and unskilled laborers, and rural communities of farmers. Over time, the old ways of their ancestors were demonized, erased, or forgotten. The religions of the book, of the one God, controlled all aspects of their lives, from birth to death. Here, nature herself was to be subjugated as a place of wild animals and dangerous predators, including savage humans, something civilized folk must establish dominion over. Instead, service to king, tithes to church, and surrendering of resources and taxes took precedence. Life still was stubbornly hard. Between warfare and deadly pandemics like the Black Death, a new type of market economy was born. Peasants who survived began to earn more money and independence from their lords and kings. Capitalism began, and with it came new ideas of the inherent rights of man. Slowly, the concept of democratic freedom for people began to spread and take hold. However, it wasn't meant for all humans. Those who didn't participate in civilization, who clung to old tribal ways, customs, and beliefs, especially those with darker skin tones, were deemed not worthy of freedom or worthy of souls. Neither were women. The domination paradigm needed slave labor to maintain its wealth, power, and status. At this time, the priests of the Orthodox religion were determined to put an end once and for all to the stubborn folk beliefs of nature, of Mother Earth, and of the old gods. They joined forces with warrior kings and lords seeking power, and over hundreds of years, they held great crusades to purge and cleanse with fire, warfare, torture, and propaganda. Many perished and lost their lives. Much knowledge of ancient science, mathematics, herbal medicine, and birth control died with them, along with whole libraries on the pyres of intolerance. Despite this vacuum, modern medicine, now the sole profession of men, was born. Modern science was born. Modern law was born. Modern technology was born. Societies grew. And after centuries of bloodshed, corruption, and warfare, the church began to lose its unquestionable grip on the minds of humans. The idea of divinely chosen kings also lost sway. Science and industry filled this void. The development of science and technology rose and became the new church. Through technology, humankind again began to look to the stars and contemplate our place in the greater universe. This technological age allowed humans to travel to all points on the Earth, to live in large settlements, to have heated and lighted homes, to create education, to have labor laws, and to establish democracy. But there was a steep price, a severed connection to nature. To the scientifically and economically minded, nature herself was reduced to inert matter, to resources for humans to master and mine in order to create wealth and civilization. The modern world either converted or decimated indigenous societies worldwide, condemning the people they found as savages, who should convert to their way of life, become slaves, or perish. Their land was claimed as the property of the victors. Which brings us to modern times. Some of the victors of modern humanity live in vast urban jungles of steel, concrete, and complex societies, or live in nearby developed suburban communities. They enjoy miracles of warmth, heat, electrical power, modern medicine, technology, industry, easily accessible food, career options, and other modern resources. Others also live in these urban centers, but they are poor, often serving the others in service roles. They lack access to nutritious food, clean water, warm homes, medicine, healthy food, non-slave wage labor, capital, education, and upward career opportunities. Instead, they survive, living lives of bare sustenance, often in black market economies, in communities that have been polluted by the refuse of modern living. This is true in most highly westernized countries. Most Western people are dependent on large corporations controlled by fewer and fewer kings of capital, who control food supplies, finance, resources, entertainment, politics, media, and military defense. Most people no longer grow their own food. Many do not have a say if their food is scientifically altered or modified. Most have no knowledge of natural medicine and are dependent on medical doctors who treat illness as problem areas in the body. Disease is chemically bombarded or cut out without considering treatment for the whole person and the relationship of health, lifestyle, and environment for prevention of disease. Even access to modern medicine to treat illness is limited by class and wealth. Large corporations now control most food production and are planting monocrops, depleting soils, creating niche opportunities for devastating crop illnesses, and clearing huge swaths of forested lands. In these places, forests are replaced with pastures for cattle to feed people with non-nutritious fast food. With the removal of these forested areas, the Earth has lost the balance of her ecosystems that sustain other life forms, and the conditions for global climate change have arisen, which threatens all life. So, too, the lands of the remaining indigenous people also disappear. The waste of the cities and the refuse of the oil and gas industry that fuels our modern lifestyle now pollute the entire planet, including air, oceans, and soils. Despite the wonders of modern technology and the comforts of modern life, many humans suffer from social malaise and disconnection. They have little interaction with the natural world. While many profess a belief in God, their religions preach unquestionable submission, vengeance on enemies, or get-rich schemes for power, money, and prestige. Many people have given up completely on modern religion, and most rely on connections provided to them through technology and social networking. They work long hours in unfulfilling service jobs at large corporations, making profit for others, creating dependency and debt by consumerism, or numbing themselves with social media, video games, television, or substance abuse. What is the purpose of all this? Is this the apex of human civilization? Science has conquered many illnesses, has discovered so many life-enriching technologies, has even taken us back to the stars that have so long inspired us. So many people wonder, at what point did we lose our way? Is it too late to correct our path? What can we learn from those who still live the old ways? Surely it is time for the modern human shapeshifter to figure out a way to change our shape once again, to create more meaningful and connected lives. How can we correct this destructive trajectory we have been on for so long? This is what we will consider in this book. This is where we begin this tale. 1. The Darkened Cauldron. On September 20th, 2019, on 6 continents around the world, millions of children, young people, and activists marched to protest the inaction of world leaders to combat global climate change. Led by Swedish teen activist Greta Thunberg, the rallies had one objective: to stress the urgency to take action now. The Earth is under siege by humans. For more than 60 years, the world's governments have conspired with transnational, multi-billion-dollar fossil fuel corporations, oligarch billionaires, and all those who profit from technologies that have contributed to unsustainable greenhouse gas emissions and pollution, which has wrought widespread environmental destruction and devastation. This has allowed the damage and climate consequences to spiral out of control. Despite urgent warnings by scientists for decades, these governments, individuals, and corporations have put profits before the health of the planet, thus jeopardizing ecosystems around the globe. After decades of state-sponsored denial and media propaganda, many people still blindly believe that climate change is not real or a threat, despite the fact that megastorms, biosphere hazards like rapidly melting ice caps, and life-threatening floods and droughts are happening all over. As I write this, Sydney, Australia, is experiencing the worst flooding and storms they have had in over 60 years, a scenario now played out repeatedly all over the planet, on 6 continents, with the glaciers of the North and South Poles melting at record speeds. If we continue this trajectory, many species may have to die for us to return to a balance, to a carrying capacity the Earth can sustain. It's a tragedy that this should be the case, as the children and activists fighting to combat global climate change around the world so urgently point out. They will be the generation to inherit what happens now. Will the damage we do to the planet, which is currently experiencing extinction of other species at alarming rates, be so grim that we too will become extinct? The Earth is ancient, and while the idea of a sentient Earth can be dismissed, ridiculed, denied, and demonized, an understanding of her as divine matrix can only be pushed down into our collective subconscious. Psychologists understand that to the principles of conscious and subconscious mind is added a third, the superconscious greater self. The Earth is believed by many to be a conscious being, which is the concept of the Gaia hypothesis. This idea, that the Earth has a consciousness, says our planet may fight back to defend herself. Mother Nature can and will destroy a destructive species. As we exploit and deplete natural resources and disrupt the delicate ecosystem balance of crucial environments, she is simultaneously awakening those children willing to defend her. As global climate change worsens, it just may be that she is fighting to bring back balance to the world by destroying overpopulation and our destructive way of modern life. We can imagine that within the Earth is an intelligence and life force, which holds the power of a solar fire burning at her core. We can envision this core as a cauldron of fire that, through human greed and indifference, is now threatened to be snuffed out. Let us start by examining the ways modern humanity is threatening this fire, endangering all life on Earth. To do so, we must recognize the systems that are creating the most harm, and Western culture, the dominant cultural paradigm and system of social organization of humanity, is the one that holds the most responsibility for the problems we have created. Its problematic legacies and roots and their consequences need to be fully recognized and corrected to move forward. Patriarchy and sexism. Death has been described as the greatest teacher of our race, in that through it, humanity realized a concept of the presence of an animating force in ourselves and in all living things, which animates life. Perhaps the only force in nature equal to death in how it has shaped ritual, religion, and worldview is birth. Fertility, mating, conception, pregnancy, and childbearing, as well as the survival of the young, were equally primal and wrought with danger, and were profound mysteries to early humans. Because of this, the first people who may have held a sanctified role for the important tasks of life and death for their tribes and communities were women. To this date, in many societies, it is women who are the midwives of childbirth, and also those who prepare the body for burial and cremation. It is women who give birth. For a very long span of history, over 4,000 years in Western culture, humanity has lived under a concept of a god who is male and all-powerful, whose rule includes warfare, religion, technology, machinery, and the family systems of humanity. Yet the idea of an exclusively male god hasn't always been the case. In the distant past, before the rise of modern civilizations, humans had a very different concept of deity. In the beginning, early humans had an idea of God that was female. The goddess. Since the 19th century, archaeologists have uncovered female forms in the archaeological record, dating back to the dimmest reaches of human prehistory. These statues of women, as misnamed by Western patriarchal-biased museums, are over 25,000 years old. They were found in caves in France and date back to the Paleolithic culture of old Europe. Their imagery consists of curvaceous female bodies with large breasts, bottoms, abdomens, hips, and thighs, usually tapering at the top and bottom. The Venus of Locel, for example, is approximately 25,000 years old. She's a full-figured female, holding a symbol that looks like the crescent moon or a bison horn, possibly carved with marks representing the passage of time. In the 1970s, archaeologist Maria Gimbutas was instrumental in her research documenting the widespread and very long presence of goddess Earth imagery in the archaeological record. She demonstrated this deity's dominance from the Paleolithic Age to the Bronze Age. The goddess's characteristics, attributes, and what she presided over all grew organically out of women's roles as mothers, grandmothers, producers, educators, craftswomen, healers, cultural leaders, and communicators with the spirit world. Her mysteries represented creation, transformation, and the cycles of rebirth. Because of this, it has been theorized that the settlements of old Europe and the Near East may have been originally matriarchal. Through archaeological excavations of tombs and temple structures, it is confirmed that women held highly valued statuses and roles. Poets and historians also recognize the goddess's presence in myth. Robert Graves, in 1948, wrote The White Goddess, where he asserted that worship of her as inspiration and divine creatrix, and her relationship to a divine son, were the basis for all poetry. He believed her worship and evolution represented the evolution of humanity. The ancient goddess evolved as humans evolved. By about the 5th century BCE, her images are often of a pregnant throne-like form, as with the image of Isis holding her son Horus, symbolic of the fertile earth. With the onset of agricultural revolution, goddess worship expanded to view her as the mother of the grain, her worship finding expression in countless forms, such as Demeter, Ceres, Rhea, Gaia, Astarte, Nerthus, and Danu, or Dawn. With the rise of Christianity in Europe, the Divine Mother was adopted within Catholic iconography and merged with the image and myths of the Holy Mother of Christ. This strategy, where the fertility cults, holy places, and folk customs of earlier earth and nature goddesses found throughout Europe were adopted by the new religion, represented a concerted effort of propaganda, syncretization, and cultural appropriation by the fathers of the church, who wanted to promote their new religion over all others. As the church gained power and became more imperial, dogmatic, and militarized, they replaced the Earth Mother everywhere with this safer and sanitized Holy Mother to worship instead. She was otherworldly and entirely removed from her natural functions, holy only through her relationship with her divine son. From goddess to god. The shift in the West from goddess to god did not happen in a vacuum or without casualties. It was part of a long complex of change. In human evolution, early civilizations did perform barbaric practices, including human sacrifice and infanticide. So too were present the violence of holy war, mass rape, and slavery. While we are certain about little of the most ancient goddess-centered beliefs and practices, we do know that over time and with the development of more militant civilizations, old beliefs degenerated. This period involved the supplication and placation of deities out of fear, where humans made offerings, including human sacrifice, to their gods to guard against natural calamities like famine and the loss of crops. In time, and for good reason, these practices were condemned. However, as civilization grew and lost the more complete older beliefs, humanity lost the awe and connection to nature, which the earlier beliefs had engendered. They no longer revered the earth. Over time, as Mother Mary took on most of the attributes of pagan Earth Mother goddesses, wherever she was embraced in Europe, the Middle East, and Africa, she never quite regained the connection to Mother Nature that predominated in the consciousness of the pagan mind. This disconnection severed humans' responsibility to respect and revere the earth, and is the legacy we inherit and live with today. Patriarchy determined then that God was male, and females were subordinate to males because of this. They believed the male creator was above, outside, and apart from creation. And while he is perfect, the world itself, the earth, is flawed. We see this reflected in the sacred texts of the Abrahamic religions, records of condemnation for those who would offer cakes to the Queen of Heaven, with instructions to destroy the groves where goddess was worshipped. Earth became inert resources to subdue and exploit. And this is where the rise of a formal and patriarchal, orthodox and imperial church, while correctly outlawing some barbaric practices, managed to destroy beneficial knowledge and important ideas by condemning all aspects of the earlier faiths and social systems as diabolical. The goddess of the earlier beliefs was now an evil demon and temptress, as were the male deities associated with her. The Burning Times. Through this fanatical suppression, especially in the Middle East and Europe, the connection to the pre-Christian ancestors and to their knowledge, wisdom, and technologies became feared and lost. This mindset introduced a ruthless brutality against people who were otherized, which has lasted down through the ages into modern times. In the end, a great sacrifice of human lives took place again. In Europe alone, from the 15th through the 18th centuries, in the name of a religion that professed peace, by the power of a combined church and state, thousands were murdered, and the practices, ceremonies, and people of the old ways were exterminated, forgotten, or driven underground. Hence, the survival of these practices became known in European culture as occult, or hidden knowledge. Under this militant patriarchy, the character of priests became united with the authority of the state. The priest now was tasked with controlling the body, especially female bodies, which held the power of birth. The church policed the mind and spiritual life to maintain control. Freedom of thought, freedom of belief, or spiritual gifts that couldn't be controlled were demonized and suspect. This included folk practices that fell outside the realm of what the priest allowed and could control: the midwife, the seer, the healer. Even art during these centuries was expected to only uphold Christian beliefs and ideals. Jealous of her initial role in birth, the priests relentlessly persecuted midwives, torturing and killing them in the thousands. While some have called this time the burning times of Europe and claimed millions lost their lives to the fanaticism of the church, scholarship has proven those numbers were greatly exaggerated. It was more like tens of thousands, most of whom were not witches or pagans or part of an organized cult, but the victims of smear campaigns, ignorance, misogyny, and mass hysteria. It was from the death of these individuals, who included those who had knowledge of natural medicine, midwifery, and folk healing, that modern science and medicine developed, as well as the legal profession. It is important to realize that the legal definition of the crime of witchcraft was crafted in the early 15th century by European lawyers interpreting biblical passages through an authoritarian lens. The inquisitors took a legal opinion on witches, which marked the start of witch burnings. They said a magic-making woman must be burned, because Christ had said that whoever left his community must be cast out, like a withered branch that one burns. Even historians who do not believe there was ever a sect of actual witches have accepted that the stereotype came about during and as a result of the Inquisition's campaign against heretics in southern France and northern Italy. The reality is that this campaign of religious cleansing happened within the European community over hundreds of years. Generations became infected with this idea that non-Christian people were demonic and worthy of torture and death. The church benefited from this greatly. They took the land, property, titles, and wealth of the people who died during the Inquisition and the burning times. This is one reason why the Catholic Church is one of the wealthiest institutions on the planet. This is also the reason why, when European people encountered other non-Christian people in the lands they conquered, it was very easy to continue the barbarism, enslavement, killing, and demonization of non-Christian faiths and societies. It had become the norm. They had done it to their neighbors and their own people. Legacy of sexism. This form of patriarchy was maintained through land ownership, the divine right of kings, access to education, wealth, and high status roles, and, most of all, through the church. Even though Jesus himself historically had female disciples in Mary Magdalene and her sister Martha, any concept of sexual equality within the early Christian church was suppressed. To this day, many branches of Christianity, including Orthodox, Roman Catholic, and significant portions of evangelical denominations, still deny full female participation as priests and preach that ideal societal organization lies in women returning to their homes and submitting to the authority of their husbands. Orthodox sects within Judaism and Islam are equally repressive toward women. God himself remains exclusively male, and his system is enforced with punitive and guilt-projecting ideologies. As patriarchy became the dominant paradigm, even as the church ceded power to the state, its leadership was open only to men. These institutions remain male-dominated to this day. Later, with civilization, came mechanization and the rise of military power, technology, and industry. This represented a concept of economic and social organization where the strongest men dominated all others and the earth. This laid the basis for all further alienated relationships between people and God, between people and people, between people and the natural world, between rulers and the ruled. The negative and controlling attitude toward women and the earth as divine female is a reflection of the attitude patriarchy has taken toward women over long ages of oppression. Today, even in most Western countries, women still suffer under male domination, especially economically. In the United States, for example, 1 in 4 women lives with her children in poverty, while older women past retirement age are 10 times more likely to live in poverty than their male counterparts. Feminist counseling theory asserts that the primary cause of intimate partner violence in the United States is patriarchal ideology, which maintains male control of women's power and bodies through patterns of intimidation, violence, isolation, and economic and physical abuse. Intimate partner violence remains a major public health concern. 22% of American women have experienced severe intimate partner violence. The problem is worldwide and exacerbated wherever patriarchal social structures maintain dominance and control. Racism. With the ascendancy of European religious imperialism came the evils of racism, xenophobia, and the enslavement and genocide of peoples who were deemed inferior savages. With this strict hierarchy of races, a completely new cultural phenomenon was born, with white Europeans at the top and everyone else falling under in subjugation. Racism is a social construct that asserts humans are not one species, but separate races from each other. This allowed hierarchies based on this lie to be created, the purpose of which is to enrich the people who propagate it and establish their economic and spiritual dominance. The motivation for brutality against those deemed inferior is an assumed sense of intellectual, religious, cultural, and racial superiority by an ethnocentric dominant culture, which results in the taking of land and wealth and a cultural or actual genocide of subdued peoples. The indigenous societies who survived were subjugated and became property, enduring rape, slavery, or forced labor. It is hard to say when this destructive paradigm began. Some believe it started with the Empire of the Greeks and their conquest of the neighboring Middle Eastern, African, and European Old Kingdoms. Others point to the overrunning of Rome, Greece, India, and Anatolia by the nomadic Aryan tribes, which began to reorder their conquered lands with a hierarchy of caste and kings. One thing is for sure. By the time Christian Rome conquered most of Europe, the methodology of patriarchal militant colonization had mastered the template. A New World Order. From around AD 200 up through the 20th century, imperial colonization created the same conditions for destroying indigenous traditional and rural communities and culture everywhere it went. In pagan times, the Romans often adopted the gods of the people they conquered into their own pantheon. But by the time Rome and the church had become one entity, their hunger for land and desire to stamp out the old ways was insatiable, as was their intolerance for other beliefs. There could be only one God and one empire. Over 1,000 years, at least 9 crusades took place in northern, western, and eastern Europe. During these crusades, which were followed by the Inquisition, the Holy Roman Church brutally exterminated pagan Europeans. This pattern was built into the European domination system of conquest and control. We need to consider How terrifying living under this system must have been for the descendants of those who survived. The rule of the church state was absolute, and any opposition was heretical and had to be destroyed. If modern psychology is correct, that generational trauma can be trapped, maintained, and continued in the minds and bodies of a people, this unhealed wound of cultural barbarism and terror has never been dealt with. Yet it is the source for the racism and colonialism still doing damage to this day. This was the continuation of the wound, begun and perpetuated over centuries by militant patriarchal Christianity. Andras Corbin Arthen, a modern pagan priest and scholar featured in this book, commented on this fact in his speech at the Parliament of the World's Religions in 2018, saying, "It isn't because the people who committed these atrocities against New World indigenous people and enslaved African people were white. It was because they were Christian. It was this form of Christianity that allowed them to justify racist genocide and cultural destruction of non-Christians, because they decided that they alone were fully human. One human race. We know from academic archaeology that humanity has evolved most likely from a common ancestor with the great apes in Africa over 2 million years ago. Since then, there have been no less than 9 different related species of human ancestors and human-type beings, what anthropology calls hominids. Human evolution began on the African savanna, with humans learning to make stone tools to scavenge the remains of big game, hunted by large predators who also hunted us, the great cats of the African plains. Since then, our species has adapted, moved, interacted with other archaic humans, such as Homo Neanderthal, and eventually ranged throughout the planet. The other hominids, as far as we know, have since died out and gone extinct. We may have successfully interbred with some of them. Perhaps our own prejudice and fears of people not like us is based on embedded racial memories from this distant past, when we competed against other human-like people for territory, food, mates, and game. Since modern humans, Homo sapiens, emerged some 200,000 years ago, we have ranged throughout the globe, the most ancient of us in Australia and the South Pacific. In all places, evolution explains that nature created conditions where humanity evolved, adapted skin tone, body size, eye color, and hair color and texture, and created new language, culture, and customs. Yet we are all human, a diverse species sharing the same root race and African ancestry. New World. The prevailing theory of how the New World became populated with ancestral Native Americans holds that groups of fully modern humans followed migrating animals over the Bering Land Bridge that existed between 15,000 and 23,000 years ago, perhaps even living on the bridge for centuries before it vanished beneath the waves after the Ice Age thaw. To some scientists, the area in and around the Bering Land Bridge is the most plausible place where ancestors of the first Americans could have been genetically isolated and become a distinct culture. Called pre-Clovis, these waves of humanity came down into North America from the Siberian tundra, carrying with them their Stone Age technology, lifestyle, and belief systems. Over time, they followed the herds down into warmer and more hospitable climates in the New World. And it is interesting to make possible connections between the ancient indigenous spiritual traditions of Far Eastern lands, such as what has become known as Taoism, with the belief systems of the Native American people, like the ancestors of the Hopi and the Quechua peoples of Peru. There is evidence that early New World settlers may have also arrived in the northeastern continent by crossing the Arctic Ocean. Tantalizing finds in Nova Scotia and Newfoundland, along with literary references to Vinland in the Scandinavian sagas, said to have been discovered by Eric the Red and Vikings traveling west, provide some factual basis to the idea that they arrived here earlier than Columbus. There are similarities and affinities in the folk traditions and oral stories of the Eastern New England Algonquin people and the Scandinavian deities. Some researchers in South America believe that ships of ancient African or Mediterranean seafaring people may have arrived during pre-colonial times in Central and South America as well. They may have left their imprint on the stone faces uncovered in the jungles inhabited by the legendary Olmec peoples. One imagines that in each case, these ancestral people brought their language, their customs, their way of life, and their cosmology to the new lands they found and settled. Yet these ancestral people, different in ethnic stock, body type, diet, language, culture, and religion, were still all modern humans. Racism is endemic in Western colonial society, and all of us hold it to some degree, even those who have suffered the most from it. African-American scholar Ibram Kendi, in his groundbreaking work, How to Be an Anti-Racist, describes how African-Americans and other marginalized people have internalized racism, due to an illusory idea that Black people and minorities can't be racist because they don't have any power. However, when racism is internalized and unconscious, it is then projected onto one's own communities, which reinforces its hold. Colonialism. The horrors of racism and colonialism have left a traumatic wound on our human psyches, which is passed down collectively and intergenerationally when it is unhealed. This is true for all people, as all have suffered in some way. Rezma Menakem explains in his book, My Grandmother's Hands, that this racialized trauma also leaves its mark in bodies, and when unhealed, is then blown through as violence onto others. As he calls it, this white body trauma, the collective unhealed wound of centuries of European internal religious strife and colonization, has been inflicted onto African and Native American people for centuries. But this is not unique to tension between white and Black people in North and South America. It is also present in Australia, New Zealand, and South Africa. Colonialism is the political offspring of religious orthodoxy. Even after the church split into Protestantism and one by one countries freed themselves from religious rule, the now powerful European states expanded their reach into other lands and founded colonies. As with Rome, they justified their domination because they believed they represented civilization and progress, or because they saw themselves as uniquely entitled through their God's grace. They fervently believed that the people they enslaved or killed to invade their lands were wholly barbaric and ungodly. From Africa, where the Portuguese began the slave trade, to the Americas, Australia, and New Zealand, all the indigenous people, their languages, family structures, traditional beliefs and religions, farming and hunting practices, and knowledge of natural medicine and healing, were feared, demonized, outlawed, and forbidden. This is the process of colonization the world over that continued up through the 20th century in places such as the United States, Canada, South America, and New Zealand. Colonialism has the following traits: subdue the native inhabitants by force, enslave the population, establish the right to rule based on some imagined bloodline, divine right, or racial hierarchy, enforce male domination and protect wealth, control and usurp land and natural resources, and maintain the power and prestige of the rulers at all costs. Colonialism is not limited to European powers. It has included empires and peoples from the Middle and Far East, as well as in the Americas, who have used this system to overcome any and all indigenous people who stood in the way of the ruling power's desire for dominance, resources, wealth, and control. Even into the 20th century, one area where patriarchal colonialism decimated indigenous people, forcing mass migrations, was Eurasia. Reverend Arda Itez, an interspiritual and humanist minister featured in this book, who practices indigenous Tuvan shamanism, explained, "My ancestors hail from the North Caucasus and as far east as Mongolia. We are Karachais, an indigenous Turkic tribe."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.